The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome along to the Big Scottish Football Podcast. I'm Stephen Mill, he's Ewen Cameron. It's episode 77 and he can barely contain the smirk on his face after results over the weekend. Look, you're wearing your chufty badge, you've got your heart strip on, you've got your heart scarf and all the rest of it there. So, I mean, just imagine had you sacked Stevie Naismith earlier on the season. I'm not going to get into that. How was your weekend, Ewen Cameron? It was all right.
Where did I begin?
It's really hard not to be smiling.
Listen, Dunfermline won again at the weekend. I'm a happy boy.
We're both very happy this weekend. It was quite a sensational weekend when it comes to the football. And we will get to that in just a wee second, but as we always do.
Can I just ask you, and again, I will say this again, I've said it many, many times. Please don't call him Jambo Bear. Do not call him Jambo Bear. But how many messages containing the word Jambo Bear did you get over the last sort of 24 hours?
Well, you should know because you were tagged in most of the tweets as well.
I was doing an event yesterday.
Whereabouts?
I was doing a sportsman's brunch in Dunfermline. It was a reunion for the 88 to 90 team who won promotion to the Premier Division under Jim Leishman.
Yes.
Stayed up as well. So it was like Giorgio Boyle was there. Esteban Cosma sent a wee
message. Nobody cares, but move on.
But anyway, I obviously was not looking at my phone because I was on the stage like doing talky things. And then I looked at the score, first of all, because it was on, like, you know, it started at midday, so yes. I totally missed the football. And I was like, oh, the Hearts are beating Celtic. And then I opened my Twitter and I had something like 324 notifications. I was like, oh, shit, what's happened now? I was like, oh, that's it, I've been cancelled, that's me. And then I was like, every single tweet was just related to you being Jambo Bear.
Jambo Bear, and everyone was retweeting the video of me dancing.
Yeah.
The happy dance. And don't worry, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I have been warming up. The happy dance will be coming very, very soon. I've been practicing all weekend after a sensational victory against Celtic yesterday. But first, let's just talk about what happened at the weekend. Now, I had a great night on Friday night. I was working at an event with Arnold Clark. It was fantastic. And I got a wee bit drunk. It's not like me to get drunk.
You had four beers.
I had four beers and I was feeling a bit rough and ready on the Saturday. Sunday, it was a quiet and relaxing one. And I know there's a lot of people out there who love my movie recommendations. Today, I do have a movie recommendation, but my recommendation is not to watch this movie.
Okay.
So I'm not even going to discuss it in any great detail.
Because great news.
I think I watched possibly just over an hour of a 2.5 hour movie.
And what was
on
it
on Saturday night? I got the kids down the stairs. My wife was sat down the stairs. We got the popcorn out. We got the sweeties out. I had the Haribos. We had ice cream. We had the juice. Sat ourselves down. We watched a new Indiana Jones movie with Harrison Ford.
I watched it on a flight a couple of months ago, and it's shite.
Yeah.
It's so shite.
How far into it did you get? I got just over an hour.
I watched it all.
Aye,
I was on the flight, so I had nothing else to do. So I was like, I may as well just get. But
it's awful.
It is, but it's still better than that Crystal Skull one that they did where he hid
in
the fridge.
When you find the aliens.
Yeah, it's better than that.
Well, anyway, I lasted an hour, and then overall shite. At the hour mark, I looked at my boys and I looked at my wife, and we all kind of like agreed this is not worth watching any further. So we turned off. So if there's anyone out there who hasn't yet seen it, you don't have to watch it. Trust Stephen and I on this one. Mm. It is a pile of dog poo. The new Indiana Jones movie. Do not watch it. That's my recommendation.
I think the Indiana Jones films are...
Don't say it. Raiders of the Lost Ark is one of the greatest movies of all time.
I think Raiders of the Lost Ark is good. I think the second one...
It's all right. Chris,
And the one with Sean Connery in my opinion, is the best one. I thought I lost your boy and all that stuff.
The original, Raiders of the Lost Ark, is usually the better one.
I think
one.
The one with Sean Connery is
anyway. So that's the movie recommendation. Do not watch the new Indiana Jones movie. It is pish beyond belief.
I'm going to do some correspondence and then you can limber up and sort of get your dance moves on the go, because I think we're going to have to
for the dance moves. Getting ready, go!
grim. Lots of people...
Don't cry for me, Brendan Rodgers!
So, remember, you can always get in touch at Big Football Scott is our Twitter feed. You can get us on Facebook and Instagram as well. And you can also leave your comments throughout the podcast if you're watching on YouTube as well. So, leave your comments below. Tell us what you like, tell us what you don't like, and that's totally fine.
Because
we love the feedback.
And I have a
feeling we'll be getting a lot of feedback on this. So you can leave your comments on YouTube. We'll read out the best of them next week. Big long username, so I'm not going to read that out. Seeing Jambo Bear doing that sad dance has mentally scarred me. Doogie says OMFG, which stands for Oh My God.
Yeah.
Please let's hope hearts start winning again, because that sad dance was absolutely horrific.
Oh, trust me. Hearts won. We're doing happy dances today.
I was ready at the start to start throwing £20 notes at my screen with A dance moves. I don't know what this username is. I wish I didn't come from Spotify to YouTube. Jambo Bear, that move was disturbing. Why are we still having the discussion about eating in the bath? That's also disgusting. We did have quite a lot of correspondence about eating in the bath again. Paul says, I don't watch the podcast on YouTube, but yesterday I tried. I saw Ewen give an erotic dance where I was trying to pretend he was sad and gave up. Why is there a picture of Fanny Craddock on the desk? Andrew says, so what went through your head to start doing a lap dance to a sad song?
You know what? A lot of people have asked me that question.
Yeah.
Last week, I was doing a sad dance after the defeat to Rangers at Ibrox. Yeah. And I didn't quite know how to...
It was a lap dance. Kenny says, Ewen's sad dance looked identical to Salma Hayek from Dusk Till Dawn.
I'll take that as a compliment. Thanks,
yeah,
mate.
There we go. Salma Hayek, of course, who is the connection to Scottish football is. Do you remember this? Producer John.
What was the connection to Scottish football with Salma Hayek?
Rob McLean tweeted Salma Hayek.
Did she?
Searching for Salma Hayek. So, Rob McLean. Ewan's impressions last week. Oh, your impressions are really bad.
No, they're not. Yoda's really good.
Ewan's Chewbacca sounds like an awful lot like Bagpuss. Sean says, for a man who's a movie expert, Ewan needs to brush up on his impressions. That Yoda one was terrible. 2 weeks running, the impression has started with what sounds like Ewan clearing his throat. Phone the doctor. Hey, RFC says, Ewan's Yoda impression sounded like Scooby-Doo with tonsillitis. What else have we got here? Excellent Mr. Bean impression whilst constipated. So lots of people actually saying Mr. Bean impression instead of the Yoda one as well. And finally, I think we can round off eating in the bath. Derek says he stands with Ewan when it comes to eating in the bath. And we received this picture.
I'll put that up on the where's the camera?
Here we go. So I'm holding up the picture. It's him with an ice cream in the bath, like an absolute monster. So that's
Ice
Derek.
Cream looks great. Also, he's even got raspberry on top of it as well.
Yeah, I know. But he's obviously gone out and wet. That looks like a Mr. Whippy, like he's gone outside.
And then got in the bath
with it. The review of the week, though, comes from Bobby Coates, which sounds like a Scottish condom company, so thanks very much. Sometimes I talk utter shite. Then I realise there's one man from Edinburgh who talks even more, and I feel so much better about myself. I wonder who he could be referring to.
Well, I'm the only one from Edinburgh here.
Well, it must be you then. Remember, you can leave your comments on YouTube. As I said at the start, we love reading them throughout the week. We actually got a very nice one. This only came in yesterday from Mick Motherwell. So he says, I'm sitting in a little town called St. Mary's in Georgia, USA on Saturday morning, ready to watch Liverpool versus Forest, and the doorbell rings. It's our bug guy here to do some routine preventative service. He noticed my garden flag and asked where I was from. He must have like a Scottish flag in the garden or whatever. Turns out he is the grandson of Will Duff, who was the Hearts Scottish Cup winning goalkeeper in 1956.
And he's related to him.
Yeah, so that's his grandson.
Right.
Chatted for a bit and already making plans to watch Scotland win the Euros this summer together. Nice young lad, sent him on his way with one of my treasure curly whirlies and a Vimto. He was ecstatic. Anyway, I sent this wee picture. I can't see it though. He's supposed to send me a picture of his grandpa's winning medal later on. Just thought it was interesting that in a small town in Georgia, a Hearts fan chapped on a Celtic fan's door. So thank you very much, Mick Motherwell.
Yes. And who was smiling at the end of the weekend? It was a Hearts fan who knocked on your door.
Absolutely.
Which leads nicely into my happy dance for the weekend.
Yes.
And my happy dance for the weekend is because Hearts, who've had an atrocious week up until yesterday, getting pumped 5-0 by Rangers and then drawn 1-1 with Hibs midweek when we actually deserved to lose. Hibs were the better team at Tynecastle.
And it wasn't a penalty.
I will agree with you on that. I thought we got very lucky in regards to getting the draw against Hibs. So going into the game yesterday, I was really not confident. I thought we were going to get pumped. I thought Celtic were going to take at least three off us and they'd be heading back down the M8 with 3 points in their back pocket and they'd go top of the league. So I wasn't confident. I was sat on the sofa and had a cover up, halfway up my face, preparing for the worst. And I was speaking to a friend of ours, big Celtic fan, Jerry Taylor, who's going to be joining us later on the show during the game. And he was also quite confident to get a result. And then, all hell breaks loose.
Then VAR gets involved
We will get to that. Lauren Shanklin again, the boy steps up, scores a great goal and all that, and we win the game by 2-0, and I have been waiting for this moment since yesterday lunchtime. So can we go to a wide shot? I don't want people looking at my crotch dancing about, but I'm ready for my happy dance. This is it. Wait, before you press play on the bit of music, can I just say, don't cry for me, Brendan Rodgers.
You've had 24 hours to come up with a second line to that song and you've failed.
I can't think of
a second line. Yeah, you can't think.
But right. It's quite funny watching on the telly greeting.
Right, John, cue up the music. Let's go. Get over with. Is that, that's the wrong
one. Oh, sorry, Ewen, I pushed the wrong button there. Sorry.
It's actually the worst joke on the show.
It's just titled Ewen's Music. And that's obviously why we get mixed up all the time.
Oh, Ewen Music's B, right?
If you play Penny Arcade next, I'm leaving.
Right, okay. Right, go for it.
Celtic! Hearts, hearts, glorious hearts. Oh, Brendan's tears brought me joy. The talk of the tune are the boys in maroon. Oh, Brendan, get it up, yeah.
So it finished Hearts 2, Celtic 0.
Hurt my knee.
At Tynecastle, yeah, you knocked the desk a couple of times there. That did sound...
I was really exuberant there because I was so happy. It was such a great result yesterday when I wasn't expecting it.
Yes. We will get to the VAR decisions and VAR WTF.
Avoid that game right now because that's the only thing you talk about.
Yeah, because, that totally changed the game.
We'll get Jerry on the Celtic fan to discuss it with us. There's a bit of balance there.
Let's go back to Saturday then, and we'll start at Ibrox. Rangers 1, Motherwell 2. So I was talking to Gordon Duncan as we were walking out the door on Saturday. He was obviously a very, very happy man. Uh-huh. And I was like...
He was celebrating in the toilet because I met him in the toilet.
Well, no wonder. It's Motherwell's first win in the top flight at Ibrox since May 1997. However, he was keen to point out Motherwell did beat Rangers at Ibrox in the playoffs.
Yeah, but in the league...
Yeah, that still counts. They still went to Ibrox and won. And I think it's their first win in the league, if you discount the playoffs, against Rangers since 2002. So it's been a long, long time.
22 years.
Since Motherwell have beaten Rangers. And a couple of really good finishes by Bear and Casey. James Tavernier had equalised for Rangers from the penalty spot. And obviously, you know, Rangers have been on a fantastic run under Philip Coulmont, only lost to Celtic up until this point. And obviously their home form has been excellent as well. So they probably didn't see that coming, I would say, on Saturday.
Did.
Especially after beating
Kilmarnock.
Kilmarnock coming from behind to beat Kilmarnock on Wednesday night, and obviously thumping Hearts last week as well.
You don't have to keep saying that.
It was 5-0 it finished.
I know.
So
the thing about Rangers' performance on Saturday, yes, they had 33 shots on goal, only 11 were on target. I thought the Motherwell keeper had a good game, made a couple of decent saves. But I thought Motherwell deserved their points, actually. I thought Motherwell deserved to win the game. I thought they were very good. Theo Bear on another day could have scored a hat-trick. I think he's a really good player. I've said a million times on this show, I do like Blair Spittal, and I thought he was outstanding against Rangers at the weekend. He hit the bar. Great opportunity. Put them 2-0 up. But I thought Motherwell were good for the result. I thought Rangers... Of all the days that every single one of the players decide to have a bad day, that was a day not to have a bad day, and they did. And they got what they deserved at the end of it.
And obviously Celtic could not take advantage yesterday. Big shout out to Scotland's coefficient on Twitter as well. I do like your account.
Yes.
Tweet some very interesting stuff. So odds of over 50-1 for Rangers and Celtic both to lose over the weekend. It's the third time in 14 years that has happened. So it happened in 2018.
That was the last time.
Kilmarnock beat Celtic 1-0 and Rangers lost at home to Hibs. It also happened again 2017-18. Rangers 1, St Johnstone 3 and Hearts 4, Celtic 0. That was when Harry Cochrane scored.
Yeah.
And then it happened again in 2010. Hearts 2, Celtic 0 and Rangers 0, Hibs 3. That might have been Ivan Sproul, actually.
Yes, it was.
He scored a hat-trick.
Yes.
Hearts' first back-to-back wins over Celtic for 18 years.
You're joking, is it?
2006, 3-0 victory and a 2-1 victory. They were both at Tynecastle, though, but obviously Aye. Celtic...
18 Celtic years?
Park. Yep.
First time we've done the double over them.
Yep. And, as I mentioned, 2002, last time Motherwell beat Rangers in the league. I know the Premiership playoffs obviously happened as well. Scotland's coefficient, if you want to follow it on Twitter. Very good account. By the way, that win for Motherwell... They're only 2 points off the top six now. I know they've played a game more than Dundee and Hibs, but considering, you know, Motherwell went something like 12 matches without winning, or 13 matches or something ludicrous like that, you know.
They've been unlucky.
They could get into the top six.
Yeah, I think they've been unlucky with some of their some of the scorelines. I think they've always played decent in games and not got the rub of the green. I thought they were very good against Celtic last week in that first half, and then Celtic battered them in the second 45. I like the job that Stuart Kettlewell's doing at Motherwell. I think they've been unlucky this season. Yes, they're threatening the top six. They won't get there. I think Hibs are on a run. They're playing good football and they had a really good win against Ross County by 2-0 and deserved their win as well. And I think that they're the team that will ultimately get in the top six ahead of Dundee, who crazily were 2-1 up with minutes to go against 10 men and get pegged back to 2-2. And that 2-2 scoreline could be the scoreline that comes back to haunt Dundee in regards to getting to the top six or not.
Yeah, absolutely. Kilmarnock just don't know when they're beaten, really, this season.
They've done that
a few times. Watkins and obviously Dees with the late goal. Lewis Mayo getting sent off. We'll talk about VAR WTF in just a wee second. As you mentioned, Hibs winning against Ross County. Fairly routine. I think, in the end. Ross County obviously had been a couple of games undefeated before that, winning a draw, but it just seems like Hibs are just kicking on at the right time. Montgomery's finally got his players in. And obviously the two boys that scored as well. One of them was a wee bit scrappy, but, you know.
They're a threat. They're a good side. And do you know what? They were very, very, and I hate saying this, but I thought they were excellent against Hearts at Tynecastle. And I can be big enough and ugly enough to admit when we played second rate to Hibs. Hibs were a better team and should have beat us on Wednesday night.
Absolutely shocking decision for the penalty.
It was Hibs so deserved to win. I understand why they were angry.
Simon Murray was missing for Ross County. He has scored nearly 30% of all the league goals this season. So he's obviously a very important player for them. So Ross County remains second bottom. Elsewhere, as you mentioned, Dundee 2, Kilmarnock 2. Dundee a point behind Hibs in the race for the top six. They're on 33 points. Hibs are in sixth on 34. Elsewhere, let's save the St Mirren game for just a wee second. St Johnstone won, Livingston won, late equaliser, Nicky Clark. He's going to be important for St Johnstone because St Johnstone can he score goals, but Nicky Clark can.
St Johnstone should have won that game and he should have got a penalty. How the referee misses the handball in that game is beyond me, but we'll get to that shortly.
We'll get to that. Livingston looked like they were going to pick up a win, which would have made it a wee bit squeaky bum time at the bottom for Ross County, but they remain 6 points adrift and they've played a game more as well. So we're getting to desperation stage for Livingston. St Johnstone, meanwhile, remain ninth, and they leap above Aberdeen, who somehow managed to chuck away 3 points at Paisley. 2 goals in stoppage time in 2 minutes, and Neil Warnock was going off his rocker at the end. Again, we'll get to VAR WTF in just a wee second, but it was a penalty. Mark O'Hara equalising, and then Aberdeen all at sea for the winner.
Yes.
They were actually on the attack. St Mirren counter-attacked, and to be fair, it looked like absolute scenes at St Mirren. It was
crazy.
Just tremendous. It was great scenes if you're a St Mirren fan. And we've all been there as football fans. We've all seen our team chuck it away in the last minute or whatever, and we've all been on the other side as well. There is no better feeling than what St Mirren did on Saturday. I think that is one of the best feelings ever in football. Just totally turn it around.
Last second goal.
Like Scotland did against Norway in the summer as well. And on the opposite side, there's no worse feeling if you're an Aberdeen fan, because that is horrendous.
The reason, and I was speaking to Jamie Langfield on Saturday night about this, that is a massive result for St Mirren because they jumped above Kilmarnock into fourth in the league. That's why there were scenes, big scenes, because they knew it was a significant result. They want European football, and the higher in the league you are, the better position you will be going into next season when it comes to European qualifiers, etc. So that battle for fourth is really intriguing. It's definitely between Killie and between St Mirren, because I don't see Hibs or Dundee catching them.
Yeah,
so big result.
7 points between Hibs and Kilmarnock, 8 between Hibs and St Mirren, and as you mentioned, St Mirren up to fourth above Kilmarnock on 42 points. What a season for Stephen Robinson. Aberdeen, though, I mean,
they're a joke of a club.
Three losses in a row.
Dave Cormack's statement the other night there.
Yet to win under Neil Warnock in the league. They play Kilmarnock in the Scottish Cup this weekend. The only team that Neil Warnock has beaten has been Bonnyrigg Rose. I mean, I think what happened was, obviously, a cracking goal by Conor Barron after just a minute or two, right in the top corner. And then they almost just sat in for the entire match. Like, they just decided, well...
He made a change.
Like, you know...
Went defensive.
We're just going to play five at the back, try and beat us... And it nearly worked, to be fair. It nearly worked.
Nearly's not good enough, though, Stephen.
No, it's absolutely not. I mean, Aberdeen, Ross County get a win. They're only a point behind Aberdeen. Anything can happen in the top, in the bottom six after the split as well.
You would not rule out Aberdeen dropping into that relegation playoff position. The way that they're playing right now, they're a complete and utter mess and a basket case of a football team. And I agree with Neil Warnock. There doesn't seem to be much character or personality. They're not physical enough. They're not in your faces. I think they're a poor, poor side.
What they should
But they've
do.
Actually got worse under Warnock. How is that possible? You've got someone like Barry Robson.
They should have a holiday and he can go down to Cornwall as well.
Well, there was a rumour flying around that he disappeared for 4 days. Yeah. And Miofsky jumped on a plane to Spain a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah. I mean, he's managed to make Miofsky look rotten. I struggle to think of a person who's come into a football team who's done a worse job so far than Neil Warnock.
Normally when you have a new manager come in, you get
There's a wee bounce.
Aye, it might take a game or two, or you might get it straight away, but he's had no bounce whatsoever.
He's consistently chucking the players under the bus. Now, obviously there are issues with the squad. There's players that are not good enough there. But come on.
Publicly, every game.
Every game, he's just been like, well, it's not my fault.
I know, they're rubbish.
It's them. Aye. I mean, obviously, the officials got it on Saturday as well. But again, we'll get to that in just a wee second. But absolutely just a shambles at Aberdeen.
Yes.
I do think they'll be fine. I don't think, even if they are in the relegation playoff, I think they'll be fine.
Oh, they'll be fine.
But
it'll be embarrassing if they fall into that playoff position.
Just absolutely... like a shambles. And you know, like Dave Cormack, this is now his what, third, fourth manager, what it is. Alan Burrows is in there now as well. Had a bit of a nightmare, let's be honest. It's not going well at all.
No.
And Dave Cormack, I think, strikes me as one of these guys that has obviously done really well in business. He sold his company for 500, 600 million, whatever it was. And, you know, when you get to that stage, I think, with a lot of people, when you've made hundreds of millions of pounds, they can't understand why things aren't going their way. Because everything else is going their way. They can do anything they want because they've got so much money.
And they've been very successful in their businesses. Why can I not get this right?
Why can I not get this right? And they'll just chuck money. Yeah. I honestly think... Aberdeen needs, I know they've got like a football consultant board as well.
Apparently that report's in.
So
they've done the consultancy, they've got this, they had these experts look at the whole running of the club and from top to bottom, and they've done the report, and apparently Dave Cormack's got that on his desk. What it says, nobody knows. And what the recommendations are, nobody knows. But we might find out in the summer. They've got a huge job there at Aberdeen. They've got a mess to sort out. Neil Warnock is clearly not the man to take them forward, so they need to identify a manager. And when they do get that manager, it has to be someone with a bit of experience. The days of Goodwin, Glass and Robson are gone. Find someone, a middle ground between giving people an opportunity and someone like Neil Warnock, who's a dinosaur, whose best days are gone. It has to be someone in the middle.
It reminds me a wee bit of when they had like Steve Patterson in. I know Ebbe Skobdal had a bit of success, got them to a cup final, and I think they maybe finished like in the top four under Skobdal as well. But they also finished like second bottom.
Yes, they did.
And obviously Steve Patterson was an absolute disaster. Then they brought in Jimmy Calderwood and Jimmy Nicol.
Jimmy Calderwood did a good job.
And absolutely rebuilt the club. It feels like Aberdeen are down at that low ebb again.
Yes.
They need somebody to come in and completely transform this, the club, because they need to do something right now. Because it's been absolutely horrendous. Right, let's move on to the championship then.
When are we doing VAR WTF?
We do that after the results.
All right, because, right, okay.
We always do that.
I'm just excited to get to this bit.
Yeah, I know. Championship, the league that nobody wants to win, basically. So Raith Rovers 2-0 up against bottom of the table Arbroath on Friday night, and then they shat themselves because they threw away, what, three goals?
I couldn't believe that.
I was 2-0 when I checked it, and I was like, oh, that's Raith 1. And then I checked it later on, and I was like, what have they done? 2-0 up against the bottom of the league. If you're going for the league title...
And you're 2-0 up against them, you have to see that out.
You have to see that out. You have to see it. Terrible defending for Raith Rovers, and Arbroath come roaring back, 3-2 winners. They're still 7 points adrift at the bottom of the table because Inverness went to Morton and won by 2-0 on Saturday. That's Morton's first defeat since November, and I know we've got our guy Ewen who wants us to talk about Morton more.
He won't want us to talk about him today.
I have a wee sneaking suspicion that he won't want us to talk about Morton today, but first defeat since November for them. So they've been on an amazing run, 14 games unbeaten.
And their bad results come at the right time with Hearts coming round the corner in the Scottish Cup.
Precisely. And to be fair to Morton, they did have two or three big players, like Oakley was out and stuff like that. So
stop making excuses for them. They got pumped.
They're obviously saving them for Monday night against Hearts. Bizarrely, Dunfermline win again. So that's four games unbeaten, two draws, two wins, 2-0 against Ayr United. Scott Brown was going absolutely off his rocker at the end of the game at how poor Ayr United was. Dunfermline, in the end, probably could have won 3-4-5-0.
Yes, easy.
Played very well. Chris Kane getting his first goal for Dunfermline as well. And this is how mental the championship is. Just a few weeks ago, we were talking about Dunfermline being in relegation bother. And to be honest, if you look at the table, we probably still are, but we're fifth.
But so, you're looking up, you're not looking down.
We're looking up as opposed to looking down, but there's only 2 points separating Dunfermline in fifth and Inverness in ninth. And obviously that's the relegation playoff spot. So Dunfermline up to fifth, only 5 points behind Morton now as well. And you know, teams do go on streaky runs in the championship. You remember Inverness a few years ago, had a terrible time under Billy Dodds. He was about getting sacked, had loads of injuries, and then he ended up getting them to the final of the playoffs under St Johnstone.
Right.
So, like, anything can... I'm not going to say that's happened to Dunfermline, by the way, but, you know, I would expect someone to come out of the pack.
Well, to put it this... I'll say it as a neutral from the outside looking in. Dunfermline, I think, have got a really good outside chance of getting into playoffs. There's more chance of that happening than them being relegated or being brought into the playoff position.
So Dunfermline brought on 5 subs on Saturday and all of them were experienced players.
Good.
And that's something that we haven't had for...
And Chris Kane from St John's has been a great signing.
Yeah, absolutely. So Dunfermline up to fifth. Elsewhere, 1-1 between Airdrie and Queen's Park. So it's as you were for them. And as I mentioned, Ayr United dropping down a year. Partick Thistle 1, Dundee United 1. So Partick Thistle stopping the raw. They'd had an absolutely terrible run of results, conceding so many goals as well. But 1-1 against Dundee United. But Dundee United are kicking themselves as well.
Chance missed
to pull clear. They are 1 point clear of Raith Rovers now. It was level going into the weekend. So Partick Thistle 1, Dundee United 1. We'll see what happens next week. It's the Fife Derby on Saturday.
Good
as
game.
Well. Raith Rovers and Dunfermline at Stars Park. Dunfermline play Airdrie tomorrow night as well. In League One, a big thumping win for Hamilton against Celtic Hearts, their best performance of the season. 5-0 it was. They scored after just about a minute. It doesn't really matter though, they are still 14 points behind Falkirk. Falkirk dropping points. Producer John against Annan, what happened on Saturday, just going through the motions. I mean, the thing is though, Hamilton are going to run out of games.
It wasn't good. It was a last minute goal. We played, we created loads of chances, but
what was the score?
It was 1-1.
Right,
last
that's all that matters.
Last kick of the
don't
ball.
Don't need your bloody excuses. It was 1-1. You dropped points.
So basically, Hamilton have 9 games left.
27 points to play for. We've got 30 points to play for because we've got a game in hand against Cove on Tuesday.
Done.
I'm not saying that, Ewan. I'm not.
The league is done. Falkirk will be playing Championship football next season. Cove beat Edinburgh City 2-0 on Saturday. Day as well, and what a game it was between Montrose and Alloa. Finished Montrose 4, Alloa 3. So Montrose are on a cracking run, only lost once in the last wee while, and they are up to third in the table. They're 10 points behind Hamilton though, but it's fairly tight.
What did Queen of the South do?
Queen of the South drew 2-2 with Stirling Albion.
Oh, did they?
And Queen of the South are eighth. They are not going to be
the
in the playoffs.
Board, did you see during the week, the whole board left the club?
Yes.
During the week.
Big problems at Queen of the South.
The whole board left the club?
Yeah.
What, like left it?
Left it,
walked out, like, I'm not coming back.
Yes.
Like, toys out the pram.
Yeah.
I'm gone.
Montrose, Aloe and Cove, only 2 points between them, and two out of those three will be in the playoffs. Kelty remain in sixth on 31 points. Again, Kelty, Stirling Albion and Queen of the South should be safe. Annan probably will be in the playoffs, and Edinburgh City will be getting relegated.
Do you know that phrase, toys out the pram? It gets used quite frequently for when someone likes having a bit of a...
With regards to you, yeah.
Yeah, toys out the pram, you get... The other one that gets said quite frequently, and I've never really understood this one, because it's not like you're going to do it or ever do it. You're throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
Well, yeah.
But even nobody's ever going to do that. I can see throwing the toys at the pram, because babies don't have any kind of like understanding of what they're doing. But for you to throw a baby out with a bathwater, I mean, that would be shocking, wouldn't it? Where did that come from, that phrase?
Child cruelty, that would be.
But where did that phrase come from?
It came from a German proverb in the 1500s.
And it's stuck ever since.
It's a common catchphrase in German, apparently. Used by the likes of Otto von Bismarck and Günter Grass.
It was just something that came to my mind when I was talking about throwing your toys out the pram, and then the other one is don't throw the baby out with the bathwater.
The meaning and intent of this English idiomatic expression is sometimes presented in different terms.
Go on.
For example, throw the champagne out with the cork.
That'd be daft.
Yeah. Don't scour the Teflon when you wash the pan.
Do you know what I've learned about non-stick pots and pans? I learned this from a chef when I was watching YouTube a couple of weeks ago. You should never use like a spoon or a fork to like stir the pasta or anything, because what you're doing, you're chipping the pan and you're chipping the pot. Always use a plastic
or a wooden
spoon. And when it comes to the, what's that slice thing called? For scooping an egg.
A fish slice thing.
You know the is that what they're called? Fish slice?
I don't care.
Spatula, right. A spatula thing. Whatever you want.
Don't ever use the metal one of them. Go and buy a plastic one or a rubber one or a silicone one to flip your eggs, because all you're doing with a metal one is that you're damaging the non-stick pan, and then what's going to happen over time, that non-stick pan is no longer going to be non-stick, and then you're going to have to buy another one.
But they don't tell you that.
No, so, they don't tell you that, but I'm telling you.
So what's happened is...
I'm telling you.
There's a conspiracy here, right? The big head honchos from the pan company...
The non-stick pan.
The non-stick pan companies have teamed up with the spatula makers and said, going to keep making metal spatulas.
But I'm telling you right now, don't buy them. I've learned a lesson.
What I'm saying is, that's an agreement that they've got in place.
That was them, but see, nowadays... In 2024, with the advent of social media and TikTok and Twitter and all that stuff, I'm going to put that advice out on TikTok, Twitter and Facebook.
It's like in Father of the Bride, when he's going around the supermarket and he's buying hot dogs. And he's like, well, I've got a can of hot dogs that have 10 hot dogs in them.
Yes.
But the buns have 12 in them.
Yes.
So he goes around and removes the two ones. So that's what's happened. He was like, so he says, this is a waste. And then he ends up getting arrested.
And what it is that the company who makes the rolls and the company that makes
the
hot dogs
have teamed up. And
we've just
uncovered another example of that.
So my
advice
to you is this. So I went through so many different frying pans and pots. And then I watched a chef, and now I've learnt my lesson, and now I have proper non-stick pans and pots, because I'm using silicon or plastic spatulas and spoons, and wooden spoons as well.
Fantastic.
When you're stirring your pasta and your rice, etc. And you'll find that your pots and your pans will clean easier if you keep it non-stick and not use metal.
Okay, great. Let's move on to League Two. And obviously, we have the main man when it comes to League
Two. We do.
It is the president, Mr. Joe Biden.
Standing our back, baby, as the march to League One glory continues. The Warriors put to bed that horror show against Clyde and extended our lead to a massive 17 points. Get the open top bus out the garage and get it ready for a Turfsten House Muir and Larboard. Those fish lovers Petter hit lost at Dumbarton, which leaves the Suns just a point behind them. There was a huge one for Jobby McCall and Clyde down at the other end of the table as they made it three wins in for with the gap now down to 3 points. And it's all about Dick and League to as Mr. Campbell's men came back for a great 3-1 win away at Spartans. They could yet mount a late charge for the playoffs. The 9 points might be a big ask to make up. Anyway, Ewen and Steven got to go as I need to go deal with that Erdry-loving Donald Trump. God bless America, and God bless League 2.
God bless you, Joe, as well. Thank you very much for taking the time. I know you're a very, very busy man. Right, let's get on to the main event, VAR WTF, shall we?
La gente está muy loca. What the fuck?
Right, lots and lots and lots to talk about.
Can we save the Celtic one until the end and then we'll give Gerry a wee call?
Right, St Mirren versus Aberdeen. We'll start there. Nick Walsh is the referee. Nicky Devlin, foul initially given as a free kick, checked, ruled inside the box for a penalty. Neil Warnock was going absolutely off his rocker penalty. At the end. It was a penalty.
It's a penalty. Sorry, Neil, penalty.
Nothing doing in the Hibs Ross County match. Craig Napier was in charge. Dundee Kilmarnock, Colin Stephen was in charge.
Penalty.
So Bexfell and Danny Armstrong, not penalty.
No, it's not a penalty.
And Lewis made Mayo's red card and resulting penalty.
Penalty, red card.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so. I do think the Danny Armstrong one.
You think it's a penalty? Could you? Okay. Mm. It's probably one of them. If he gives it, you're going, yeah, I can see why they've given it. It was 50-50.
I'd be disappointed with that. St Johnstone won, Livingston won, Chris Graham in charge, Mickey Devlin, handball, not even checked by VAR. What is going on?
They checked the one after. So when he kicked it, it kicked up into his hand. But just before that, when he was going up for the header, he actually stops the St Johnstone player from heading it towards goal because he had his arm up and he hit his arm and bounced away.
As I've said,
they missed it. They
a million times.
How did they miss it? How?
This is what frustrates me and so many other people. It's so inconsistent.
But the thing is, though, it's blatant. You can see it.
No, I know.
You can see that he's got his arm up above his head and it's hit his arm. It stopped the St. Johnstone striker from heading it towards goal. How have they not seen that and they've gone and checked the one after it? That's crazy. You watched the entire play.
I think it was
just... it's crazy. Crazy.
Possible high foot. Shinny's goal.
Shinny's goal. Nah, you're all right.
Right, Rangers 1, Motherwell 2. Alan Muir was in charge. So Desser's goal ruled out for offside.
Correct.
Was offside. Stephen O'Donnell and Casey double team for Silva for Rangers penalty.
Penalty. There's definite contact.
Aye.
Silva flicks it over the sliding O'Donnell.
Again.
Flicks over. It's a good bit of skill from Silva and O'Donnell takes him out. O'Donnell takes him out. He didn't get any of the ball.
No,
you cannot say that's not a penalty.
No, I think it was, but it's one of those ones where I was just...
you think it's soft?
It's soft. I think but it's probably a penalty. Dan Casey's tackle on Ross McCausland wasn't checked. Now, I saw lots of Rangers fans going on about this on social media. I didn't see it, obviously, at the time because I wasn't at the match. And then I saw it and I was like... I don't really know what the issue is. Now, obviously, McCausland's picked up an injury, and that's sad for the boy because he's obviously broken through. But I thought, you know, McCausland jumped in as well.
Yeah.
And the guy catches him with his knee. He pulls out the challenge and catches him with his knee. Now, it looks like a sore one.
Yes.
But McCausland sticks his leg in as well.
On first viewing, at full speed, from where the camera's up in the main stand, I think it's a red card. When you see it from behind and Dan Casey's running towards goal and you see the challenge, I don't think it's a red card. No. I think it's yellow at worst, and that's it. He wins the ball as well.
Yeah.
I don't think it's a red card. My first initial thought was it is, but it's not.
From the main stand view, like, I'd only
from
seen
a
it...
From a side-on view.
I'd only seen it from the side-on... from the behind view. And from the side-on view, I mean, he's about 5 yards away when he wins the ball.
And
it slides through, and you see him. He pulls his leg back.
Yes,
and he does catch McCausland, but with his knee.
Yes, it's not a red card.
It's not a red card.
No,
I'm not
having that as a red card.
Right, let's go to Hearts versus Celtic. Then John Beaton was the VAR.
As Brendan Rodgers was happy to tell us about.
Yes, exactly. And it was Don Robertson who was in charge there. So
for a wee bit of balance. During the game yesterday, I was speaking to Gerry Taylor, who's a big Celtic man.
He's been on the podcast before.
What's the podcast he works with, John?
Celtic State of Mind.
Celtic State of Mind. He works, it's a really popular Celtic podcast. And we were chatting before the game and during the game on WhatsApp. And I asked him after the game if he'd come on the day. So he's standing by to speak to us as Jerry Taylor from the Celtic State of Mind podcast. Can you give him a phone, John?
He's going to ignore your call, isn't he?
Hello?
Hey, Jerry Taylor!
Just get over with, will you?
Just get over with, will you? Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, Jerry Taylor.
Good morning, Ewan. Good morning, Stephen. How are you?
Good morning, Jerry. Yeah, thanks for coming on. Listen, obviously, you'll be absolutely spewing after yesterday. I'm having to deal with this clown in the studio as well, dancing about. Hearts 2, Celtic 0. So we've already sort of covered the match. Just got you on for a wee bit of balance in terms of the VAR decisions. Brendan Rodgers was furious after the game yesterday. So let's talk about them individually. I mean, first of all, the Celtic penalty that was missed, Ida missed it, obviously. It was Cochrane on Yang. Now, I'm completely neutral here. I would say I thought that was incredibly soft. I didn't think it was a penalty. Ewan, your thoughts on that?
I don't think either of them are penalties, but let's just talk about this one first. It's 100% not a penalty, and I would go as far to say that it could have been also a bit of simulation there, and it could have been a possible yellow card for Yang, because I think he throws himself to the deck. It's never a penalty in a million years. Jerry, your thoughts as a Celtic fan? How did you see it?
See, you're on the fence again, as usual. You. look, you're screaming for them for your team, and if you get it against you, then you're going to complain. But I just think it was a penalty. I can see why people aren't saying it, but I'm a Celtic fan, so at the end of the day, it doesn't matter, because he does put it straight down the middle and missed it. But I think all round, I know you would want to do them one by one, but I think all round, the referees had a shocking game.
Right, hold on a minute, Jerry. Jerry, just going back to that one, right, with Yang and Cochrane. Let me then just turn that, and that's a challenge from Taylor on Dessers.
Right, we're going back to that game. Well, it's inconsistency, isn't it?
No. But if that's Taylor instead of Cochrane on Dessers instead of Yang, and that's given as a penalty, you're still saying that's a penalty?
Of all the decisions that were given, I would say that was probably the most harsh. The least harsh compared to the other ones. Because I think, you know what, if it's given, it's given. If it's not, it's not. It's one of those ones that both sides are going to argue. I think it was a penalty.
You're giving it because it was for your team?
No, but there's contact there, isn't
there?
But
Jerry, you're saying you're given that penalty because it's good for your team, but if it's against your team, you wouldn't give it.
I think that's the case for that one.
Yeah. I mean, by the way,
that's another one I was screaming about, obviously, because I'm a Celtic fan.
I'd probably be the same myself.
100%. And listen, you're always going to view things through your team's lens, basically. Like, I mean, that's completely normal for a football fan, whether it's Hearts, whether it's Celtic, whether it's Dunfermline, whether it's Scotland, whatever it is. I thought, like, you know, sitting aside, and to be fair, I didn't see the match live. I had to watch the highlights last night because I was working, but I thought it was incredibly harsh. And obviously, it didn't matter in the end because he missed it anyway.
So we've got that one out the way.
Before we get to the red card, let's go to the handball, just so we're sticking with penalties then. So it was
never a penalty.
Given against Iwata. Again, I saw that and I was like, how have they given a penalty for that?
It's never a penalty in a million years, is it, Jerry?
If that's a penalty, the game's gone.
I agree.
If that's a penalty, the game is absolutely gone. You can find that 2-3 times a match, probably. If you're really looking for it, and that's what it seems to be, sometimes VAR are really looking for it, and this isn't a conspiracy thing. I mean, across the board. It's just, I think some of them think, are they on a bonus if they give a decision? It was an absolute joke. An absolute joke.
Jerry, here's my issue with VAR, not just in Scotland, but it would appear to be the case across Europe and around the world when it comes to VAR. Referees are looking to give a penalty or they're looking not to give a goal. They're desperate to find any infringement not to give the goal or to find a foul or a penalty or a handball when there's nothing really to look at. And I agree with you 100%. See that penalty that Hearts get? It's never a penalty. In my lifetime, in your lifetime, in a million years, is that a penalty? Now,
You go to, sorry you to interrupt, you go 24 hours before that and it's St Johnstone Livingston, Mikey Devlin. That handball wasn't even checked by VAR. And
crazy.
That was more, like, I was like, well, how can that be
crazy?
Not even checked? But
crazy.
Then the one, yes.
The game's been refereed off the park now. That's
yes.
the way it seems. It's
yeah.
not been refereed on the park. It's killing it, if you ask me. And it's the same, we're complaining about it pretty much every second week. But There were decisions that went against and for that just were wrong. I mean, the Kelly offside, I don't think that was offside.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, it was all round. I just thought it was terrible. Potential to be an absolutely brilliant game. Probably was for the neutrals, but if we both had 11 men, I think that would have been an absolute belter of a game.
Obviously, Lauren Shanklin got a goal ruled out for offside. He was offside. It was
just,
tight. It was just
yeah.
offside. So
was
they did.
Just offside? See, I couldn't see it. I've not watched it too many times.
The reason you didn't see me because you were crying.
Exactly.
You had tears in your eyes.
Yeah.
And it didn't help that I was WhatsApping you all afternoon.
No, it didn't help. Do you know how hard it is to take criticism off a guy that can't cook fucking rice?
So we can agree they got that one right. 100%. Eventually.
They got that one right.
Yeah. However, obviously, a lot of chat about Yang's yellow card for a high boot upgraded to a red card. Ewen, you can go first on this one.
Again, and
Jerry. Here we go. Is this going to be attempted murder here, Ewen?
No, definitely not. Jerry, as we discussed on WhatsApp yesterday, and you and I are in agreement with this, and I've said it all season, and I've been consistent with this for two seasons, I always think that the high boot red card is harsh. Unless there's proper connection and you're causing actual injury, I think it's harsh. And I've said that when it's gone against us, when it's gone for us over the years, whether it be Dundee United Hearts, whether it had been, who was it recently?
There was a Kilmarnock incident.
Yes, and we were like going, all
season.
Of it for me is harsh. I thought St Mirren against Celtic in January, it was harsh, the sending off, and I thought yesterday it was harsh, and I was shocked. And this is my biggest shock with this, right? Is that Don Robertson, who I quite like as a referee, and particularly recently when just a few weeks ago at Ibrox, Don Robertson was asked to go and look at the monitor after he'd sent Stirling off for Rangers against Aberdeen. He went to the monitor and he told Willie Collum, GTF, I'm sticking to my original decision. That's a red card. Stirling, get your ass down the tunnel and into the bath. Yeah. You're off. And I thought, fair play to the boy. He stood by his initial decision. I genuinely believe, this was my belief, when John Beaton says to Don Robertson, go across and have a look at that. That's a high boot. I think that might be dangerous play. I thought that Don Robertson would come back and go, that's a yellow card. I'm sticking by my decision. So when he upgraded it to a red, it surprised me. But here's the thing though, Jerry, and this is where I have an issue with Brendan Rodgers and what he said yesterday and his after-match comments when he singled out John Beaton. I thought that was bang out of order. At the end of the day, Don Robertson was the referee on the pitch who makes the decision. It was his call to send off Iwata, and Don Robertson has already proven this season that he's quite happy to stick to his original decision and tell VAR where to go. Now, what I think has happened here, seems to be some sort of unwritten law where any high boot in the head or the face is deemed dangerous and is a red card. And even Brendan Rodgers said that himself. Now, I sent you that quote in the WhatsApp group that we had yesterday. Do you remember that quote I sent you that Brendan Rodgers said about St Mirren? So St Mirren got a player sent off after a high boot challenge on Joe Hart. And this is Brendan Rodgers' quote because he disagreed with Chris Sutton, who thought the red card was harsh. He said, the guy's not meaning to do it, but of course, if you're taking a stud in the eye, it's dangerous play. It was clearly a red card. Now, if you didn't know that Brendan Rodgers has said that, you'd have thought that was Naismith saying that, because yesterday's high boot from Yang did catch Cochrane under the eye, and it was a high boot. I don't think it's a red card, but by Brendan Rodgers' logic, that was a red card yesterday.
And there's always a quote somewhere, isn't there?
Yeah.
Always a quote. But yeah, look, I agree that in the rules of the game, you put your boot up that high, if it does make contact with someone's face like that, then it is a red card. We all know it's going to be. I don't think it's fair, because some of them you see that there's no malice, there's no intent.
Agreed.
There's no follow through, anything like that.
Agreed.
So yes, I agree in the rules of the game, he's got to go, but it needs to be looked at, because like I say, there's no malice. If you look at the St Mirren game, what, a couple of months ago, when the St Mirren boy basically put his foot right through Joe Hart's face and drew blood, and it was a yellow card. So it's just, there's too many grey areas.
And I think you're right, Jerry. I think if we're going to be balanced here about the inconsistencies, now, Steve and I talked about this, there was a Goldson incident, I think it was against Motherwell, that led to a goal. There was a high boot from Goldson on a Motherwell defender. And then it led to, I think, Silva scoring a deflected goal. And we sat here a couple of weeks ago and we thought, in the rules of the game and the laws of the game, Goldson's lucky not to get booked and for that goal not to be chopped off, because that led to a goal for Rangers. I think there was another incident where there was a Motherwell player last week against Celtic with a high boot and nothing came of it on a Celtic, but I can't remember who it was. I think it might have been Theo Bear.
Yeah, I mean,
so I think the problem here, Jerry, is that you're right. Nine times out of ten, it will be a red card, but the inconsistencies is what annoys you and annoys me.
And also, Jerry, sorry just to cut in here as well. I've been saying this all season on the podcast. There's almost no such thing as a yellow card challenge anymore. Like, I think Yang, that is quite clearly a yellow card.
Agreed.
Like, you know...
Agreed.
It was a bit out of control. But as you said, no malice, no intent. Cochrane was fine.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like there wasn't any great drama there. He's clearly going for the ball and Cochrane puts his head
Cochrane doesn't even claim for anything.
Exactly. So I've been saying all season, there's no such thing as a yellow card anymore, because as soon as they go over to the monitor and look at either a still image or a slowed down image, it makes everything look a million times worse. And I can totally understand why he's upgraded to a red card. If he's gone across and looked at the monitor and looked at the still images, because as you said, Jerry, like, you know, if you look at it in that context, then it's going to be a red card. But it's just, it's not. It's a yellow card every day of the week. Every day of the week.
The good thing is, lads, they're going to get rid of all this confusion when they introduce the blue card into the game.
Yeah, exactly.
Here's another one for you, Jerry, is I was listening to, a former referee was saying this. There might be a rule that might come into place for next season, if not next season, at some point not too far away, where they might deem any challenge above the waist as a red card.
Any challenge above? Well,
We're high boot.
I think we get rid of all the referees, just every man for himself, go for it.
I agree.
Well,
self-referee the games. That's what we can do.
Jerry, we used to do that as kids. We refereed our own games.
Exactly, referee your own games. Yeah. It was all fine back then. Now, listen, Jerry, we're going to let you go because you've had to listen to Ewen rant on for ages there and gloat. But thanks very much for joining us as well, all right?
No worries. I just want to ask you a question. So you've had Naismith in and out more times in the hokey-cokey this year. So where's he sitting now? And are you still in a title race?
You're being a smart arse here, aren't you, mate, with these questions?
No, but that's a good question.
No, it's not
that's
a good question.
A good question for
what
Jerry.
Kind of fucking question is that? Or do you still want Naismith to do? We're saying third delay. What kind of fucking question is that?
But the second part of the question, I mean, because obviously last week you were saying you're not in a title race, but, you know, are you back in a title race now after that result yesterday?
I wouldn't go as far to say we're in a title race, Jerry, but we might catch you lot for second.
On that note, I'm getting to fuck right. You
anyway, Jerry, see, before you go, I know you work on the podcast. What's the name of the podcast again?
It's called A Celtic State of Mind.
Celtic State of Mind. It is a great wee podcast. You're on there. You've also got your own show coming up as well.
I've got my own show called Blame It in the Bucky, but it's doing a tour. It's basically a comedy play about a family that have lost granny's corpse on the morning of a funeral because the two guys were fished. So, and it's basically a journey about I'm 7 months sober now, so it's basically about my 12-step journey put into a comedy show. So that'll be touring September this year.
Nice one.
Brilliant,
nice
Jerry.
One.
Can I get tickets?
Aye, but I tell you what, I picked the wrong season to stop fucking drinking, that's for sure.
Jerry, give me some tickets for that show of yours.
It'd be great to see you, and lads, on a serious note, watching your show and other podcasts got me through. So you're a big part of a lot of people's 12 steps. So keep doing what you're doing. Keep pumping him at the quiz, Stephen, because it's absolute gold.
Thank you very much.
Love you, Jerry. Take care, mate. I'll speak to you soon.
All the best, mate.
Cheers, bud.
Bye-bye.
Cheers, there goes Jerry Taylor on the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Right, let's move on. We have still lots and lots to get through, unfortunately.
Press a button then.
Come on, John!
Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Right, start, stop, sell, our version of Snog, Marry, Avoid. Last week we decided on animals. So it was start, a shark, a dog, a kangaroo, start, stop, sell. So...
Yeah, what did I choose again?
You chose...
I chose a shark because you wouldn't allow me to have a millipede the size of a dog.
Nicola Doyle says, start dog, give him the captain's armband. Plus, if he's a wee dog, get him in defence. He can nip the ankles of the other players. Sub kangaroo, get him in goal if we're struggling to get the balls out and have him bounce about like he's Jack Butland, saving right, left and centre, and sell the shark. I'm a shite bag and fair to them. So there we are. Dave says, start the kangaroo because he can jump at everyone. Sub the dog as he can come on late with his speed and sell the shark because he's a big ugly bastard. I think that's that hard. Craig says, start the shark because he's lethal in attack. Sub the dog, always reliable in midfield, will fetch and carry all day. I think that's absolutely. And a kangaroo selling him, too unpredictable and always wants to start a fight.
Do you know what I found out this week? I was looking up stats on kangaroos and I can't remember why. And I'm going to blow your mind with a stat about a kangaroo.
Cool, I'll finish this.
No, I'm going to... No, you need to hear it.
Well, I thought you'd forgotten it.
No. Kangaroos cannot walk backwards.
Why would they need to walk backwards?
Well, most things can walk backwards, but for some strange reason, a kangaroo cannot walk backwards.
Well, it's obviously to do with their...
It can only move forward.
Yeah, it's probably to do with the way that they're built.
Yeah, but isn't that strange? Think about it.
Can all animals walk backwards, though, Ewan? I'm just trying to think of a, you know, dog. Yeah, I've seen a dog walk backwards.
Cats can walk backwards. Hamsters.
Could an elephant walk backwards?
Yeah, I've seen elephants walk backwards.
Have you seen an elephant walk backwards?
Aye.
I don't think you have.
Go and Google animals that can't walk backwards.
Right.
Okay, John says, start a dog, loyalty, and won't let you down. Sell the kangaroo, or sell the shark, as you say. Unreliable, highly like to be sent off in every game, and sub the kangaroo.
Oh, I watched a shark have sex the other day there.
Handy to come on to win a few balls. No, it wasn't. I know exactly what you're meaning.
It was two sharks.
It wasn't. It was two whales, and it's the first time...
Two whales.
It was the first time they've caught two male whales having sex.
It wasn't the shark. Are you sure it's whales? It was whales, not sharks.
Because I saw the same story. Also... Killer whales are killing lots of sharks.
Did you see the video of that one going round of this? Aye. This killer whale just...
Killer whales are fucking psychopaths.
Yeah.
Like, they are psychos. Like, and in fact, they're sociopaths, right? Because they psych you out as well, and they're killing all the sharks. There we go. John says, start a dog. Loyalty, won't let you down. Kangaroo on the bench, handy to come in and win a few balls in the air and sell the shark. Elsewhere, P. MacB says, start the shark, can chew up defences, an absolute predator in front of the target. Bench kangaroo, always good to hop towards the end and sell the dog, he's howling. RJ says, start the shark, sub the kangaroo, sell the dog. Sharks are unique and superb creatures. Rua Demon says, start the kangaroo, top player for 90 minutes and he wouldn't take any shit. Sub the dog, come on near the end of his pace and defenders are tired and sell the shark, as this is football, not fucking water polo. we've got a few more starts for the dog. Overall, I would say, though, your votes are as follows. Starting the dog, subbing the kangaroo, and binning the shark.
Binning the shark?
Binning the shark.
That was my choice.
Emus are the only other animal that can't walk backwards.
Emus. So kangaroos and emus are the only animals on the planet.
Apparently so. Every other animal can walk backwards. Oh. One elephant can't run backwards. It can only walk. There you go.
I mean, it is quite hard to run backwards whether you're an animal or a human. I mean, because of the balance, it's quite difficult.
Okay.
Do you ever race in the car park afterwards to see who wins running backwards?
No, I don't.
You're just boring, aren't you?
No, I'm not boring at all. Okay, a reminder, Clyde on Super Scoreboard is on every single night, midweek night from 6 p.m. Taking your calls on 01419511025. Gordon Duncan in charge with all the lads there on Clyde One.
I wonder what they'll talk about tonight.
And you can watch on YouTube as well, obviously, as well. And myself and Ewan on with the Big Scottish Football Show. It's a big Saturday football show, John. And that's on 4th One, West FM, TFM, MFR, NORTHSOUND 1, every Saturday from 2 o'clock with former Hibs and Aberdeen striker Steve Cowan. Right. Are we doing another start, stub, sell? What are we doing? Or are we going?
No, I know what to do next week.
I know I say this every week, but we're so late for Jose. Like, we're so late for Jose.
Hold on a wee second.
We need to be so quick with this.
Right. Somebody sent me a message.
Quick means high of speed.
Right, okay.
It was the manager's, Ewan.
Yeah, I know, but I'm trying to remember who
Jesus,
the boy was.
Suffering. Steph! Christ almighty.
Steph, what about this for a start, sub, sell idea? Alex Ferguson, Pep Guardiola and Jose Mourinho.
Right, okay.
Are we happy with that?
Happy with that.
That was Steph with that suggestion.
We're going Jose, Pep and Fergie.
Okay. How can you leave out Klopp, though?
Because he's one fuck-all compared with them. So, Jose...
That's the job he did at Dortmund and Liverpool when he doesn't have the resources of Bayern Munich or the Man City or the Man United.
He's won a couple of league cups.
And Sir Alex Ferguson, you could argue, was a checkbook manager when he went to Man United.
Oh!
It's true. If you look at the spending power over the years of the Premier League, Man United were at the top of the spending power until Chelsea came into fruition with Abramovich. You could argue that Ferguson is a checkbook manager and got extremely lucky that the class of 92 came through when it did, and you had fuck all to do with that. It was the people in the academy that brought those boys through. So there's an argument there that Fergie shouldn't even be on that list because he had the most money, he had the biggest football club, and he could sign whoever he wanted and made them the best club in Britain. He only won one Champions League in all the years he was there. I'm not having him on there.
He won two for a start.
Jurgen Klopp. Jurgen Klopp.
Like most people who don't have a fucking clue about football, the fucking football didn't start when the Premier League started. Fergie did quite a lot before we got to 1992.
Yeah, but
winning the Cup Winners' Cup with Aberdeen, winning three Scottish Cups in a row.
I'll give you that then. But we're talking about Mourinho versus Ferguson versus Pep Guardiola.
Right, so you're just ignoring that part of Fergie's career then?
No, I'm not ignoring that part of his career.
So I would argue.
But his most success came.
I would argue. His most success, like, he won the Cup Winners' Cup with
Aberdeen. I know
Aberdeen.
What he did with Aberdeen, but is what he did with
Real Madrid in the final.
Okay, is what he
Bayern Munich on the way.
Is what he did. Is what he did with Aberdeen better than what Klopp did with Borussia Dortmund and Liverpool?
Yes. Absolutely. Indisputably.
I'm not sure about that.
What did Jurgen Klopp win at Dortmund then? What did he win?
He stopped Bayern Munich. Of Bayern Munich on a couple of occasions, and he got them to a Champions League final.
So Aberdeen managed to beat Real Madrid and Bayern Munich and Celtic and Rangers.
Right, do you know what I'm doing here? I'm putting the question out there. Could you argue, forget what he did at Aberdeen, because we're talking about Premiership managers? No, we're not. I'm asking the question.
Could you win 13 titles or something?
Could you argue that Sir Alex Ferguson was a checkbook manager?
No.
He spent more than anybody else in his entire time he was at Man United.
Okay, Walter Smith
and spent 30 million on Rio Ferdinand from Leeds United back in the day. He spent 28 million on Rooney. He spent 30 million on Juan Sebastian Veron and Black. And I could go on and on and on.
Right.
Nobody else was spending money like that in England at that time until Abramovich came in. I'm just asking.
That's because they had the money to do it.
I'm just asking the question, could you label him a checkbook manager?
Would you say the same about Walter Smith in the 90s with Rangers then?
Yes.
They were spending more money than anyone.
I would argue you could easily call them a checkbook manager.
So Walter Smith,
he was very good at what he does, and Ferguson's very good at what he does. But
you're just dismissing both those people as checkbook managers.
But you have to take into consideration.
How much money did Mourinho spend at Chelsea?
I was just going to say that Mourinho himself also.
How much money has Pep spent at Manchester City?
I'm just getting there. Mourinho again. The money that he got.
How much money has Klopp spent at Liverpool?
Did they get
Virgil van Dijk on a free?
Yeah, but they took the money. They spent what they sold.
Right.
So they took the 150 million for Coutinho and bought Alisson and Van Dijk for that money.
So were Man United spending money that they didn't have?
Stephen, you're taking us way a bit too seriously.
No, you're just talking shite.
I was about to say, Mourinho is also somebody you could label a checkbook manager. I'm saying... Now, Mourinho gets that thrown at him that he's a checkbook manager. I'm asking the question, is Ferguson a checkbook manager? If you're going to label Mourinho...
It's a bollocks question because it's an absolutely nonsense question because every single person that we've mentioned there, the reason they're at the top clubs is because they're really good managers. They've proven it elsewhere. And when you get to the top clubs, you get more money to spend. So it's a nonsense argument. A nonsense argument.
Anyway, I'm selling Sir Alex Ferguson.
Right, cool. Go for it.
I'm joking.
Jurgen Klopp's obviously a great manager.
So we're not including Jurgen Klopp in this argument?
He's not even in the same realm.
Okay, let's go with these three then. So who are you starting?
Fergie.
John? Producer John?
Fergie.
Right.
Sell Mourinho.
Yeah, I'm with Steven.
I think Mourinho, like what Fergie Fergie had success over the course of 30 years.
For me, Pep Guardiola has revolutionised football and revolutionised the game that we watch today and love. Pep starts for me. So Alex Ferguson is a sub, and Mourinho is like, no doubt about it, I'm selling him 100%.
Well, I think, you know, again, we could sit here and argue all day, like, but I think Fergie has had success with a smaller club like Aberdeen in the grand scheme of things, you know, European success.
We've always been very complimentary about that. Amazing.
I know. And I think the fact that
I'm talking about the Premier League.
Yes, but he won 13 Premier League titles.
I'm just asking the question, is he a checkbook manager? You say no.
No.
I would say he was similar to...
But you're going to start Pep, who's definitely not a checkbook manager.
I'm talking about the style of football. He revolutionised football.
He's revolutionised football. You've just totally changed there.
He's revolutionised football.
No, but you've just totally changed
that. That's why I'm starting Pep and I'm subbing.
Fergie famously playing shite football that was really boring to watch.
Alex Ferguson, I've got
right,
the utmost
respect.
Let's
call Jose because it's about 4 o'clock in the
afternoon. Jose Mourinho!
we'll phone Jose. Jose. We are so late. He's not going to answer.
I don't think he'll answer.
Because he'll be sitting down at his dinner. It's so late. We've been recording this for about 5 hours.
This is live, mate. As live. We don't do edits on the show.
Hello, boys.
Jose! Where are you, Jose?
Good. What's up, boy?
Where are you? Very noisy. Where are you?
Where are you?
No, I was in a school, the primary school.
All right, okay. Are you finished?
Yeah, no, I can talk, no problem, yeah.
Excellent, how was your weekend?
Yeah, where I done my weekend? I was somewhere in Tesla, a charity thing.
Oh, what are you? Who were you playing with?
I went myself, I was invited.
Right.
I went myself, yeah. Was good.
Excellent.
Yeah, I was steaming, dancing the table.
No, you weren't, you don't drink. Don't try who and fool us.
Who tell you that I'm drinking? Me?
You don't.
You were dancing on the table.
Yeah, do backflip on the table.
No, you're at it. You're teetotal.
Nearly broke my head. Yeah.
You nearly broke your head.
Did you pull, Jose?
Yeah, I'm kidding. I'm joking, boys.
Did you pull on Saturday night?
No. See when I'm going out? I look cool as anything, yeah. But all the lads are like, Jose. I say, no. I'm happy to wear him.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you not need a woman in your life, Jose?
No. I'm not. No.
You don't want a woman in your life?
No.
Ever?
You know what? I'm like, I feel good, like, with myself, eh? I love my own company.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's good.
So you prefer to hang about with yourself?
What if we set someone up for you, though?
Yeah,
I mean, that didn't take much to twist your arm there, Jose.
No, listen, guys, if you said me, no problem, I can go on a date and take it all out and then see what happens.
Exactly, we'll see. We'll get that sorted for you. What you got on the rest of the week? Anything exciting? Just working?
Just coaching. Just busy coaching. But I played two games yesterday. Oh, my God.
Are you sore?
Yeah, no, I put actually the second game in Hamilton. The first kick of the game, I pulled my tie. Oh. I can't walk now.
Oh, mate.
What a nightmare.
Do you want me to send producer John round to rub your thigh?
No, it's okay. I'm going to be okay because, you know what I mean? I'm being put ice and massage.
Ah, right. Okay, got you, my man. Well, listen, you have a great week, Jose Quitongo. You know how much we love you.
Oh, I love you too, guys.
Right.
I love you too. Thank you so much.
See you later, Jose. Bye bye.
See you later. Bye bye.
Bye, buds.
Bye 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 bye.
Jose.
Right, Scottish football's even harder, greatest, harder, hardest question.
Oh, we got a new one.
Yeah, we did it last week, remember? What's the connection between Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres?
Oh, I saw loads of people having a guess at that.
Key McLeod says he's stuck down a rabbit hole. Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres are both mentioned in Simon Hughes' book Ring of Fire. Or Morris Malpass and Kenny Dalglish were teammates in Scotland. Dalglish managed Torres at Liverpool.
Oh.
Or is it both have scored against Nottingham Forest in a cup game? Morris Malpass in the 1987 UEFA Cup and Torres in the FA Cup for Liverpool. Both their goals were scored at home, Tannadice and Anfield. What an answer that is. Local Sheep says, Morris Malpass was a one-man club with Dundee United. Jeffrey Hayes, what the fuck are you doing, Ewen? Sit on your arse.
I need a pen.
Jeffrey Hayes, the presenter of Rainbow, was a Dundee United fan, having lived in the city in the 60s. Hayes says that he asked the producers of Rainbow to make Zippy the puppet tangerine in colour to match Dundee United colours. On 14th of March 2013, Fernando Torres scored his second goal for Chelsea against Steaua Bucharest in the Europa League, I should say, with cult children's TV hero Zippy from Rainbow in the stands at Stamford Bridge. I don't know if that's correct. Nicola Doyle says, hardest question, I think I may have underestimated this. Fernando Torres and Morris Malpass both made their debuts in 1984. Absolutely not. Andrew says, is the connection between Morris Malpass and Torres the fact they were both at one club for all across three decades? No, they weren't, because Fernando Torres played with loads of clubs.
Anyone get that right?
Nobody getting it right.
Anyone close?
Some good answers.
Anyone get it close?
No. So, what is the connection between Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres? It's Scottish football's greatest, even harder, hardest question. Get your answers in on YouTube, on @BigFootballScott, and we'll keep going until somebody gets it right. Even my mate, who takes time off his work to actually like do these questions, he's nowhere near it.
Not close. Completely off, cold, not even warm or hot, just completely cold.
Well, I mean, I don't know about that. I mean, there's a few.
There's a few that are in and around the right
in
thing.
And around the right realm, I would say, right? So get your answers in on YouTube, @BigFootballScott. What's the connection between Fernando Torres and Morris Malpass? Let's move on to the quiz, please, producer Don, because I'm very hungry and I want to eat my lunch. So it's the penalty shootout quiz. It's me versus Ewan. The score is 20.5. to 5.5 after the draw last week.
Yeah.
And Ewan, has Ewan got movie questions this week again?
Yes, he has. I couldn't remember. We were doing half points, but just null and void last
right,
week.
Right, let's decide who goes first. I'll go heads.
And it's tails. I'll go first.
Great. Right, okay, right. Let's get cracked on. It's either questions here, so you'll get one. I'll get one. We've got a top bin question that's worth 2 points. And we'll keep going until we get a winner.
Excellent. Let's go then, will we?
Yes, yeah. Ewan first. Here we go.
There we go.
And that mines are movies.
Please don't take ages, Ewan.
Right. Just because you're hungry, just shut your
We've
face.
We've been in this studio for about 5 hours.
You're That's a lie. Quite hangry now. I can notice.
That's a lie. Just minutes. That's a lie. Yeah. That's right. A
hurry
lie.
Hurry up.
Right. Okay. Right, Ewan. Your first movie question. What number was the last Fast and Furious film to be released? What number are we up to now in the Fast and Furious film franchise?
It's Fast X, which would be 10. Or was it an 11th one? It's either 10 or 11.
10! Final answer!
10, final answer!
Get in!
It is indeed. It's Fast and Furious 10. I think they're making an 11, aren't they?
They are making an 11, yeah, the last one.
Stephen, what musical instrument is on the Hibs badge?
A harp, final answer.
Oh, you... Jeez, that was quick.
Good, right. Ewan.
Yeah, go on, mate.
The stage play Everybody Comes to Rick's was adapted for the screen to become what 40s film? The stage play Everybody Comes to Rick's was adapted for the screen to become what 40s film?
Everybody Comes to Rick's mm-hmm. then became a screenplay to a movie in the 40s.
Yeah.
Everybody Comes to Rick's. Is it Casablanca? Rick's being the piano player in Casablanca. They went there to see the piano boy. Is it that, or is it the one that the girl from the Darling Buds of May starred in? Catherine Zeta-Jones. The jazz, is it, what was it, the jazz thing? Cabaret, is it that?
Zorro.
I'm going to go Casablanca final answer.
Well done.
Well done. Fantastic. Right, Stephen, what Spanish club is Yanis Hadji currently on loan at?
It's my juice.
What are you doing?
It's my juice. It's orange juice. I want to make sure I get all the goodness on the top of the juice.
Is it with bits or smooth, Ewan?
It's with bits. I can't eat the smooth. Drink the smoothie. I need the bitty bits.
Aye.
And then they get tiny wee bits.
Is it Celt of Ego, final answer?
I wasn't finished talking about orange juice.
Final answer?
Yeah. Bollocks.
Oh, brilliant. Oh, you're fucking... Get in. You got
Alaves.
Alaves. I'm 2-1 up. Oh, happy dance is coming to end the show.
All right, okay. Ewan.
Yeah, go on.
In Risky Business, what song did Tom Cruise famously lip sync to in his underwear? You can see him sliding across the floor with his candlestick, but what song was he sliding?
It's Bob Seger.
Don't give him clues!
That's not a clue!
Of course it's a clue!
How is that a clue?
Of course it's a clue! Jesus!
Rock and roll. Here I go. Rock and roll. It's Bob Seger. It's something rock and roll. Do you have to get the...
Yes! The name of the song.
Yeah.
And he slides and he's white shirt and he's boxers. Oh, just
fucking answer the question, man.
Old style rock and roll, final answer.
Old style rock and roll.
Final answer.
I can't give it to you.
Fuck, no.
It's not the name of the song.
Yes. It's old time rock and roll.
No, no.
What do you mean, not?
It's not the name
It's not the name of the song. It's not the name of the song.
I'm going to throw that chair through that telly.
It's not the name of the song.
Really?
Well, style and time is not the same word.
Right, move on.
I don't ask you what the style
You're
is.
You're the one who wants to hurry up, shut your face, and answer the next question.
Right, go.
If I fucking lose this quiz, I'm going to go ape shit.
Steven.
You're giggling because you know
that. No, it's the. It's not what the song's called.
Shut up.
Right, Stephen, sing the next line of this football song. Hearts, hearts, glorious hearts.
It's down at Tynecastle they bide.
Sing it.
It's down at Tynecastle they bide. Final answer.
I thought you would enjoy that question, Ewen.
2-2. Right, give me question 3.
Ewen, who provides the voice of Lightning McQueen in the Cars films? Three Cars films has been the voice of Lightning McQueen.
I know. My kids loved that film when they were wee. See if I lose it for time and style or whatever it is. I'm not going to be happy. Lightning McQueen. I can hear him. The red car. Mm-hmm. I can see him.
It was red.
Yes, I know.
Ka-chow. That was his famous catchphrase.
Stop giving him clues.
How is that a clue, Stephen?
It's not a clue.
Ewen, just answer the question.
I'll be here all day. I'll no get it. I'm going to have to pass.
You're not just going to say just a random person?
Have I just said pass? Right. What part of pass do you not understand?
You're passing.
Right, let's just move on.
Right, okay.
And Marshall is saved!
That means you didn't get it right. No points.
Owen Wilson.
Owen Wilson!
Stephen.
Yep.
Who was the last non-Old Firm player to win the PFA Player of the Year in Scotland?
Jesus Christ, man.
The last non-Old Firm.
Hurry up, Steve. I'm going to get my lunch because I'm really hungry.
My lunch?
Hurry, just answer the question. Just answer it. Come on, what are you doing? Just you do it with me. I'm really hungry. I want to get out of here. I've been here for 5 years.
We have been here for hours.
Right, just answer the question and we'll get here soon. Oh, now it's fine for you because you want to fucking think.
Honestly, haven't got a Scooby.
If you think about it, you'll get it.
You're really annoying.
Uh-huh. Well, you now know how I feel when I play in this.
You're
fucking
really
quiz
annoying.
Were you and your pish fucking shite crap chat?
I've got no idea.
It's going to be 2-2 going into question
5.
I'll
go Craig Gordon.
I actually thought you were right there.
It was Michael Higden. 2012-2013.
I've never got that.
That is the last, but unbelievable.
Are we 2-2 at question 4?
We are.
No, question 5.
We're on question 5, but after 4 questions, we're 2-2. Uh-huh. Oh, you beauty, right? Come on, let's do this. Sudden death now.
What is the name of the psycho in the Alfred Hitchcock movie, Ewen?
Do you need both names? Or can I just go with the... It's Bates.
I need both.
Oh my god, why are you being so specific?
It's
if I was
Bates.
On Countdown, I just
absolutely
Bates.
No. What's his name?
Not Countdown. If I was, on Mastermind and I was sat across from Magnus Magnusson and I went Bates, he'd go correct. There's a point.
Magnus Magnusson wouldn't be doing much. I don't know.
I don't think he would.
Oh, no, yes. It's George Alagaya does it now.
It's just big George that does it now.
No, he's dead as well.
No, he's not.
George Alagaya definitely dead. It's Clive Myrie who does it.
Oh, yes, Clive Myrie. Oh, my God.
Why are you just saying dead people? Dead quiz hosts? Oh, when Richard Whiteley was on Countdown, he'd have given you that, yeah.
Aye, but...
Bob Holness? Jim Bone dead?
I don't know if Jim Bone is dead.
Jim Bone
is dead,
isn't
it? Bruce Forsyth
from Cards Play Your Cards Right. He's dead as well. It's Bates! Why do I need to give both answers here?
Because that's his name,
the main
what's
part
your
of
name?
The...
Ewen Cameron. If someone just referred to you as Cameron, that would not be your name.
He makes a good point there, Ewen, to be fair.
I know it's not Simon Bates.
Oh my, Gregory Bates, David Bates, John Bates, Graham.
David Bates
Grant.
Played with Rangers. No, he was a centre half.
Oh my God. If I lose this today with a new Owen Wilson and I get old style rock and
roll.
Right,
just give an answer.
I'm having a merry Ewen.
Bates.
Just pick a random name. Billy Bates.
Bates. The Bates Motel. Mm. Jeremy Bates. Jeremy Bates? No. Why are you laughing? Do you know the answer?
No.
Right.
Do you know the answer?
Well, why are you laughing there? Because it could be
Jeremy Bates. Like, Jeremy Bates is somebody else.
Right. Oh, is he a tennis player?
I think he might be. Jeremy Bates was a tennis player.
A British former tennis player. There he is.
Andy Bates. Boris. Colin.
Boris Bates!
Colin.
Colin Bates!
We have not got all data.
Right,
you
just pick a name.
ABC. Yeah, Frank. It's no Frank.
Frank Bates.
Gee, Gary Bates. Not Gary Bates. Harry. No.
This is excruciating listening to anybody watching or listening to this podcast.
Ian Bates.
Shouting.
Is it Ian? No, Ian. It's not Ian. Xander. Alexander.
I thought this was an easy
Steve.
Question.
Stephen Bates. No, it's not Stephen. This sounds like a scary name.
I was expecting Stephen to throw his toys out the pram today after this question. I thought it was easy, but there you are.
But I've got it. I've said Bates. I'm
not Ewen. Just please give a name and we can all go home.
Roger Bates. No, it's not Roger. Duncan Bates. I'm just going through the Super Scoreboard, boys. Mark. Is it Mark? Mark Bates. Mark Bates. Johnny Bates. Is it Johnny Bates?
Right, Ewen, pick a name.
Oh, have I said the name?
No, Sharp. Pick a name.
Johnny Bates, final answer.
Johnny Bates, final answer. Funnily enough, it's not Johnny Bates.
Have I said the name?
Nah.
Have I not?
Norman Bates.
Oh, so it is. Norman Bates.
Yes,
of course
Norman
it is.
Norman Bates.
God.
Oh my God, this is for the win, Stephen.
The only reason I know that is there's a wee bit in Mrs. Doubtfire where he loses
right.
He loses the face and he's still got the wig on. He's like, oh, Norman Bates.
Yeah.
Right, Stephen, this is for the win. Let's see if you can do a better job than Adam Eder did.
Mm-mm.
Who is the pot one team in Scotland's Nation League group?
That's like giving him a question.
Ewen,
Norman Bates,
As if it was like a penalty with knee goalkeeper.
You had a shooty in with that.
It was a
question.
Penalty with knee goalkeeper. That question,
an absolute shooty in.
And if it was Eden,
Right, I'm down to two.
Oh, shut up! You're just, you know, you're doing here.
No, I'm not.
So our group, you're doing it to wind me up.
Our group is Portugal, Croatia, and Poland. Don't chuck stuff at me.
Right, just say the answer.
Croatia. The only reason I'm swithering.
I'm swithering my arse.
Is because Croatia got to the final of the last Nations League.
Who cares? Just say it. Just say it. You
but
know
I
it.
Think it's Portugal. Have final answer.
Portugal. Final answer.
Of course it is.
Saved.
You're joking! You're joking! I'm back in! Oh, you beat! I was leaving! Is
look
it
his, just look at his face!
Is it Croatia?
Just look at his face! It's Croatia, yeah.
Get it right! What are we doing now? Oh, it's a tie break! Is that a tiebreak?
It's a tiebreak. Unless you want to take on your top bin questions.
Aye.
Yeah.
Let's do the top bin questions for each of us. So, movie for me, go.
Oh!
Right, Ewen.
Uh-huh.
What movie did Steven Spielberg win his first Oscar for Best Director?
Colour Purple, I think it is. I think it's a Colour Purple. Oh, God, that's a great question. Let me just think. I think it might be the Colour Purple. Or was it Saving Private Ryan?
Jurassic Park.
It's not Jurassic Park.
I think it might have been Jurassic Park.
Colour Purple, final answer. What?
Schindler's List.
Schindler's List, yes, what a film.
Steven, this is for the win. Name any one of the four players in the Premiership that are currently on 9 yellow cards.
Jesus, suffering.
Looks like Christ it's going to be another draw this week.
Graham Shinney, final answer.
Graham Shinney? Just.
Graham Shinney.
Right at the back.
It's a draw! Get my happy music danced on! Come on, come on!
Not for a draw, you loser.
Yeah.
Do you want the happy dance music?
Yeah.
Forgetting a draw.
Mate, I've only had 5 victories. This is like a victory for me.
Play the end music. Play the end
music. H-E-A-R-T-S. What a weekend for the Hearts.
What was the answers, by the way?
You could have had Owen Beck, Daniel Phillips, Keanu Backus, or Michael Devlin.
I would never have got any of them. This has been the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Thank you for watching this marathon podcast. And thank you for all your comments that are about to come flooding in through various things on YouTube at Big Football Scott as well. Remember, you can subscribe in all your usual podcast places. Leave us a 5-star review despite what's happening to the left of me. And you can watch us and leave your comments on YouTube as well. Just search for @Clyde1SSB. That is where we are. We've got our own wee video section there. And we'll be back next time on the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Clyde with Super Scoreboard on from 6 p.m. during the week as well. And we are all going to go home now and get in touch for question time. Sorry, the Scottish football's hardest question. Leave your answers there. Start sub sell, and we'll catch you next week. Bye bye. If I'm still here,
bye.
I probably will be. Love as well, you. Get out of bed.
See you, Brendan. Take care.